Now, this is part two on the message that I've been preaching on the book of James, chapter 2, verse 14 through 26. Just a quick review. The first part of this message, I reviewed what the word works, used here in the book of James, chapter 2, translates to. The word is ergon, E-R-G-O-N in the Greek. It involves the employment of something. Usually, when you employ what God's word says, it means the employment of the word of God in your life, or a commission that he gives someone to carry out. For instance, carrying out the Great Commission to go make disciples. And we picked it up with verse 14, what do it profit, my brethren, though a man say he had faith? And I told you, faith there is pistis, P-I-S-T-I-S, not pisteo, but pistis. Pistis is like level one of faith. That's the type of pistis, faith come by hearing, pistis come by hearing, and hearing the word of God. Pistis is hearing and then being persuaded what you heard to be true. But there's still an application needs to take place. And when you start applying, taking, or acting on God's word and have full trust and confidence in it, you move into level two of faith, or a different level, a higher level of faith, an increased level of faith, because you're trusting and having confidence in what God's word has said to be true. So, say he had faith. Just adjusting my microphone, it's falling down. Though a man say he have faith and have not works, not works like a to-do list, not like works that most Christians and pastors and preachers have formulated, the things that you need to do to become a good Christian or stay saved as a Christian. No, not those kind of things. What the word means and how the verse should be read is, and have not the employment of the word, can faith save him? And that's where I brought up last message, in the last message, about professing Christians. A lot of professing Christians. And everybody's saying they're a Christian. That's a fad in the Christian world. But are they faithing Christians? Are they acting in faith, trusting and having confidence in God's word when those challenges come by? And they'll come by. I guarantee you they'll come by. And have not the employment of the word of God, can faith save him? You can hear all you want, like I said in the last message. And you could be persuaded what you hear is true, or possibly true, or just say it's true. But if you leave it on that shelf, James goes to say, what good is it? You've got to put it in application. It's there for you to use. It's how you get righteousness in your life that God places in your being through his Holy Spirit. And then we jumped over. Even so, faith, verse 17. Let me jump over. I didn't jump over it in the first part of the message. We read through the verses, but let me jump over tonight. Even so, faith, if it had not works or the employment of the word in your life, is dead, being alone or by itself. Hearing faith, persuaded what you heard to be true, if you leave it there, eventually it'll die. And I've seen that happen to many of the Christians, too many Christians along my journey of faith. I've seen it happen with my faith. When I get in, not recently, it seems like everything comes at me left and right these days, but especially my younger years. Oh, I just soaked it all in. I learned all I could about God's word and hearing about faith. But the challenges didn't come as hard or as often as they do now. Now, if I don't apply the pisteo faith, I find myself on my keister saying, what the heck happened? I might do that at times right now, but I'll get right back up. And saying, well, you knocked me down, devil. But I'm faithing, trusting and having confidence, pisteo faith in God. And I'm going to employ the word of God, which I've been persuaded and which I have heard and come to understand, to come right back up at you and land you a few of the blows from a heavenly perspective, from God's word perspective. So even so, if faith had not works or employment of the word of God is dead, being alone. Yea, man may say, thou hast faith and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show you thee my faith by my works. And oh, how one side of the camp of the Christian community have jumped on James for that. And I will show thee my faith by my employment of the word. And I told you, go out to Christian communities, and they'll all say, oh, I have faith, I have faith. And see how they have application of the word of God in their lives. I'm willing to gamble on a sure thing, because I know it's for sure once you do the research. There are a lot of professing Christians out there saying they have faith. Faith, 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 faith. James. Paul does it too, by the way. James challenges, okay, great. You know how to say it. Let's see you live it. Let's see you live it. You ever had somebody walk up to you and just say, well, you have to have faith? Oh, get off of it. Don't state the obvious. Over the years, I got smarter. I said, okay, define it for me. Describe it. Tell me how I get it. And of course, the most common answer was, you just have to believe. What a cop-out. What a demonstration of your intelligence of God's word. I wouldn't even call you pre-K. In your Christian education. You're not even at that level. If that's your answer, well, you got to believe. Tell me how. Describe it. Define it to me. Make it make sense. Well, not all things are going to make sense. Baloney. That's why I'm fascinated at reading your remarks in the last days, because you're starting to see things make sense. It was left up there in the woo-woo land. Some things are not to be known. And why is it in God's book to start with? Why is God playing games with us? I don't think he is. But that's how it's been described and defined. I'll show you my faith, what I've been persuaded and what I know to be true, by the employment of the word in my life. I'll take it to the next level. James saying, and he goes on by saying in the next verse what that next level is. Thou believest, there the word is pisteo. Thou faith that there is one God. Thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. They also faith is pisteo again and tremble. Literally, like I said, struck with extreme fear, they stiffened up. They stiffen up out of pisteo Christian. Think about it. I'm so tired of Christians being knocked around. There's a reason why you're being knocked around. We all are getting knocked around. But you could avoid being knocked down. And most of you are knocked down because you're not at this level of faith, the so be it faith, the pisteo faith, the faith that has all trust and confidence in God, No matter how hard you're going to be knocked around, you're not going to be knocked down. You go back to Acts. Paul in that storm. Everyone around them were in fear. They knew for sure they were going to die. They were not just knocked around. They were down. They were down for the count, except Paul. Except Paul. He's being knocked around in that boat also as they're going through the storm. In fact, the boat breaks up and then they're swimming for their lives. And then once Paul gets on those shores, tries to build a fire, and guess what? Lo and behold, a snake comes, a viper, and bites him. And a poisonous one. And everyone, once again, operates in fear. Except Paul. He shook it off. Knocked around, but not knocked down. There's an important truth to that, folks. You don't hear much of it anymore in the Christian world because they're all about self-pity and pity and feeling sorry for you. And although, priest, isn't that what God has destined for you, so you must be doing something wrong? No! If you're being knocked around, you're probably doing something right. Making some kind of impact on the devil's territory. Verse 20. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead. I'm sorry. James was never describing a to-do list, a checklist of what a Christian should do in the material sense or in the physical sense. He was describing what a Christian should do, how it employs the word of God, both in the physical and the spiritual sense in his life, and also in the Great Commission. Not what man-made traditions developed. Not by going to choir practice. Not by going to the pancake prayer breakfast. Not by doing this. Not by doing that. Sorry. Not even by mowing the church lawn or cleaning its bathrooms or whatever the pastor asks you to do. And as I said before, that's not wrong for your pastor to ask you to do that. In fact, with a joyous heart, you should want to do it. You should want to do it. But that's works. Sorry, I know it's going to disturb some, but that's works. Unless it's directly involved in employing the word of God, it's works. Tell me where a church choir is employing the word of God. Well, music's part of the ministry. No, it's not. The ministry always been defined, and it's very simple to see once you take your spiritual blinders out or off. There's only one definition of a ministry, and that's employing the word. Paul, James, whoever. Jesus didn't come to sing you to death. Jesus didn't come to have hallelujah fits. He came to preach and teach, heal, and deliver individuals from demons. I guess Jesus was just too busy to form a choir practice. I guess Jesus was too busy to go to a prayer breakfast. Well, he had communion. He had a last dinner before his horrible death. Which he didn't even eat at. And he used it as a symbol. What Christians should do to remember him and what he did for you. Do it in remembrance of me, he said. The table of the Lord primary reason and focus should be to put your attention on Him, not yourself. Well, don't you believe there's healing at the table of the Lord? Yes, if the primary focus is on Him. I've known too many Christians that have been taught that idea of there's healing at the table of the Lord, and they go to the table of the Lord just for the purpose to keep their minds on themselves. And why wouldn't they? They are suffering. But you couldn't heal yourself. That's why you went there in the first place. So while you're going there, forget about yourself for a minute. And first, remember what He did for you. I'm a believer of Christ first, no matter what I preach on. It's like fasting. For the people that have written to this ministry, placing their comments through the emails and phone calls, you have no clue what fasting symbolizes. I am so convinced of it. You really don't. And if it has any application in the New Testament, you really don't. Well, let me give you a clue. And someday I'll get there. Jesus, paraphrase, said, "Why are you bothering my disciples? Yes, they're not fasting like you hypocrites. Why should they? I'm here with them." Well, let me give you a clue. Is Christ not still here? Or is the Comforter and the Holy Spirit that was given to us as a Comforter not true? And should we be fasting in these days and times since Christ's death? And if you were fasting anyway, should fasting be anything concerning you if it was done properly? Like I said, most of you have no clue. You have no clue because you have your belief systems based upon what traditional church teachings have been teaching about fasting. And even the Protestant perspective, it actually comes from more of a Catholic background. And ancient mystery religions out of the Middle East. You have no clue. So you build up these traditions, these belief systems, you really don't know why. You've been told that's maybe a good thing, and it's important, but you don't even know why it is. I would like everyone tonight that's listening to me to let me know what you think, why you should be fasting in these times and days, or why anyone should be fasting since Christ died and was resurrected, and furthermore, He didn't leave us alone. He sent a Comforter. So is Christ with us or not? Well, He was in a physical sense with the disciples. That's why they didn't have to fast. Is He not just as real in the spiritual sense? This ministry is designed to make you think through traditions. I'm not here because I couldn't do anything else. That's the furthest thing from the truth. I have proven I'm not like these Bible school thumping preachers that have no other choice because that's what they went to school and spent tens of thousands of dollars on their education to do. I don't sit in that camp. The reason why this ministry exists is because I know I was called and chosen to do what I'm doing when I was 17 years old. And I drifted from those purposes because I really didn't want to do it. But I'm sick. Christ and His Word has been misrepresented. And that's why this ministry exists. That's why I just don't get along or like know-it-all Christians. Before I started this message, I was commenting how I'm still learning. There's not a day that goes by that something new does not pop up. But yet, so many Christians become stale. As I said, they become permanent, unmovable, or they retreat. They're never advancing forward and increasing the mind of Christ because they develop an attitude that they don't need to know anything else. I'm sorry. To get to heaven, no, you don't. You need to know and faith in, not just in the pistis level, but also in the pisteo level, that Christ died for you. You need to faith in Him and realize He's the one that provided your salvation through the gift of grace. He's recognized you back to the Father, reconciled you back to the Father. And through Him, you'll get there. Yes. But most Christians just don't stay at that point of view. They march on forward in their journey to become know-it-all Christians. Especially the Christians that read the Bible through every year. And they have it almost memorized. And they know exactly what the Word of the Lord is saying. I've come across a few of those kind of Christians. God help if they try to even provide any assistance in a newborn Christian. They'll just confuse them. Right from the beginning. With their ill-conceived ideas, what the Word of God says. Actually, if you really think about it, what James is saying, the devil's faith in God. And they tremble, and they have fear, and they stiffen up. When even, it's a matter of just, if it's coming from a heavenly source or an earthly source, that means me and you. But if they come in the presence of true pisteo, a true pisteo Christian that has begun, gone beyond the pistis level, some of this should start making sense to you folks that have been listening through the spiritual warfare series that I've been teaching, especially about the breastplate, how I laid out all the significance of the breastplate and its meaning, and how Satan perceives it when he looks on my spiritual armor. He freezes because I have it. I have it. When I start believing it, being persuaded that it's true what God's Word says. And God's even granted us enough grace that we don't even need to be in certain levels of faith to even have that spiritual armor on. But just imagine when we do get to that pisteo level of faith, the so be it faith. That stops the devil in his tracks. Like I said, the Greek word comes with the meaning that it just stiffens up, freezes. I have teachers listen to me tonight. When you reprimand a kid, a child, especially a younger child, some of the older ones have become immune to discipline, especially a younger child, and they know they're in trouble, what do? They freeze up. because they know they're in trouble. Well, Satan and his minions know they're in trouble when they see that level of pisteo. And then James gets the two examples in the remainder of the chapter. He reveals to us two examples. Now, if James was trying to press the law on us, he could have picked examples, many examples, from the Mosaic timeline of the law all the way up to Jesus. But he didn't. And I told you last message, in the last message, that towards the end of the message, isn't it ironic that James chose two individuals, and not just any two individuals, the father of faith, who existed before the law, and a whore that was not at that time part of the children of Israel. But she demonstrated a level of faith that took her just beyond words and required action, the type of action that would put all her trust and confidence to what she heard, not only to be true, she was going to literally base the remainder of her life on it. She could have been caught, and they could have eliminated her and her family, the people of Jericho. She took a chance. But first, before we get there, let's move on. But without, know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead. Without the plummet of the word is dead. Was not Abraham our father justified by works, or became righteous? We see that in Romans 4. Was not Abraham our father righteous, become righteous by the plummet of the word of God, literally, right there. Was not Abraham our father imputed with righteousness by the employment of the word of God when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Go to Genesis 22. And I'll read through this story quickly. Genesis 22. Let's just go through verse 1 through verse 6. And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt or tried Abraham and said unto him, Abraham, and he said, Behold, here am I. I'm sure if Abraham knew the real reason why God was trying to get his attention, he probably would have tried to hide or definitely wouldn't respond. But he did. Behold, here am I. And he said, Take now thy son, thy only son, Isaac. Now, Abraham had another son, Ishmael. But that son was not the son that was promised by God to Abraham. That son was a product of Abraham and his wife, Sarah, scheming up a plot to produce a child with a handmaiden. They went outside of God's plan. They went outside of God's purposes of why he wanted this child, Isaac, to come from Abraham and Sarah. And that had bigger implications because if you track the lineage all the way through Jesus, it had its purposes. And he said, Take now thy son, thy only. Even God's recognizing this is thy only son. You might have had another son, but this is the son of promise, where eventually my only begotten son will be part of that family lineage. Think about it. And he said, Take now thy son, thy only son, Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, or literally chosen by Jehovah, and offer him there for a burnt offering. Just think about it, folks. I don't have time to go how they prepare this burnt offering, but it was a gruesome sight if you put a humanistic view on it. Even with an animal being sacrificed, imagine a human. Think about it. And offer him there for burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I'll tell thee of. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took two of his young men with him, and Isaac his son, and cleaved the wood for the burnt offering, and rose up and went unto the place of which God had told him. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said unto his young men, Men, abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship and come again to you. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac his son. And he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and they went both of them together. And Isaac spake unto Abraham his father and said, My father, and he said, Here I, my son. And he said, Behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? Even Isaac recognized that they didn't have the proper animal sacrifice that was part of the burnt offering available to them at that time. And Abraham said, My son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. Now, besides what you've been taught or what you come to understand about God's word, how old Isaac was, he wasn't a child. That's what makes this story even more amazing. Because even though we're focusing on Abraham's faith here, the hidden message here is, look at Isaac's faith. Most of the New Testament or the Old Testament, there's not much that happens in Isaac's life. I'm telling you right now, I don't know about you, but as a young man, probably around, I believe, in his 30s, and possibly even 33, he experienced one of the most ultimate faith challenges that you possibly can experience. And Abraham said, My son, God will provide him a lamb for a burnt offering. So they went both of them together. There is no resistance on Isaac's part at this point. And they came to a place where God had told of them. And Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son. No resistance. Isaac accepted what was about to happen. He was ready to lose his life. I believe we know why. And that's why the faith in Isaac amazes me here. And I'll get to that in a minute. And bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. Now, you go to Genesis 15 to lay down the story as fast as I can here. Start with verse 1. After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, Fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. And Abram said, Lord God, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, Behold, to me thou hast given no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, This shall not be thine heir. But he that shall come forth out of thy own bowels shall be thine heir. Not someone else substituting for an heir. No. One's coming from your own bowels. And he brought him forth abroad and said, Look now toward heaven and tell the stars. What did Abraham have to do? Tell the stars. He had to profess it. And going beyond professing, start acting and faithing, trusting and having confidence with God, just about ready to tell him what actually come to pass. And he brought him forth abroad and said, Look now towards heaven and tell the stars, if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, So shall thy seed be. And what did Abraham do? And he believed, or literally faithed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for righteousness. Now Abraham at this point between verse 5 and 6 could have said, You know, Lord, that's all fine and dandy. But you're telling me my heirs, my offspring, and all their generations, literally, are going to be larger than all the stars that I could count here tonight? God said yes. Now, Abram at this point still, could have argued with God. He could have said, No way. This can't be true. Stop leading me on, God. Enough's enough. And many other reasons. But he didn't. He faithed in the Lord, and the Lord saw that, was pleased with it, and literally he imputed him with righteousness. So when we get to chapter 22, which I just read to you first, you see Abraham in such a state of faith that he understood that if he would sacrifice Isaac, and I believe he even told, we don't have that record here, but there's no other explanation. He even told his son Isaac not to fear. This is what God said, and it was promised through you. You are my only son in God's eyes. Through you, the promise would be revealed. And I'm sure he told them the story of all the stars he counted that night. And I'm sure there were plenty. And how God saw that faith and imputed him with righteousness. Well, where do you get that from? You go back to Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11. What does Hebrews 11 say? Verse 17 and 18 and 19. By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up. There it says, by faith. Abraham, when he was tried, by what Abraham literally was persuaded to be known to be true, he was then tried, and he offered Isaac, and he that had received the promise offered up his only begotten, of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called, accounting that God was able to raise up even from the dead, from whence also he received him in a figure. There's nothing you could have told Abraham, I believe, even Isaac, that you might lose your life, Isaac. I could see a father telling his son that. But don't fear. God has given us promises. We just have to keep faithing. We have to employ what God's word has told us. We just cannot believe it and sure we're persuaded to be true. We have now to apply it to our lives. And God is testing us to see if we will apply it. To see if we will apply it. Or is it just more words? Well, you know the story. As Abraham was raising the knife to sacrifice his son, it was stopped. It was stopped. And God provided an animal sacrifice. Abraham came through the test. Isaac came through the test. And you go back to James, chapter 2, verse 21. Was not Abraham our father righteous by the employment of the word of God when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made complete, literally. Seeth that how faith wrought with his employment of the word, what he heard from God a time prior to that moment of offering his son up as a sacrifice, Isaac as a living sacrifice, he was persuaded by what he heard. So he had to then take it from the faith wrought with his employment of what he heard, his application of what he heard. And by the employment of God's word was faith made complete. Made complete. I'm sorry. It's not works defined by man-made definitions. It is works that require God's word employed in your life. Have not I been saying that for years now? And it's not here in James. James just has a unique way of saying this. Paul said the same thing. They all did. From Old and New Testament. And the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, Abraham, this is where it now gets complete stage. And the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, Abraham believed. There the word is pisteo. The so be it faith. He faithed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness. And he was called the friend of God. Romans 4:3. Where does Paul and James differ in this subject? They don't. Romans 4:3. For what the scripture Abraham believed, this is Paul now talking, there he said, faith also, pisteo, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. For now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of death. But to him that worketh not, but faith on him that justifieth or become righteous, the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Paul's saying the same thing, that for if Abraham were justified without pisteo faith, it would have been works, but it wasn't. You go to verse 23 back in James chapter 2, and the scripture was fulfilled which saith, Abraham faithed, pisteo God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. Ye see then how that by works again, the employment of the word, a man is justified or become righteous. When you apply God's word in your life and you have trust and confidence, what he says, it is true and it will come to pass in your life. You become righteous and not by faith only. You see that how then by the employment of the word of God, a man becomes righteous and not by pieces only. Not by just hearing it and not just being persuaded that, okay, it's true, but acting upon it. Acting upon it. And that's where you can apply the ABC of faith, as my mentor used to apply it, the action based upon belief sustained by confidence, because that then moves you to that kind of level of faith. And then he goes on to give us another example. Likewise, also was not Rahab the harlot justified by works, ergon there, when she had received the messengers and had sent them out another way. For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without the works is dead also. So faith without the employment of the word is dead also. Here, at the very last example in this chapter, he's using another person that had no concept of the law. This is a person living in Jericho. Oh, she heard about the children of Israel. She heard how they were conquering and how the events went down when they left Egypt. And she was persuaded by what she heard. But she was just not sitting on that information. She took it to a next level. She took it also to the pisteo level. And she started acting, employing the word of God, what she did here to be true. So she started trusting and having confidence, not in what she was receiving in Jericho, whatever belief system they were practicing, but by what the children of Israel were practicing, a faith in a God that she only heard about. She didn't even see anyone until the spies came and lodged in her facilities for whatever reason. That's an interesting story just by itself. You find the story in Joshua chapter 2. Let's go there. Joshua chapter 2. I'll go through it quickly. I won't read you the whole story, but we pick it up with Joshua sending spies in chapter 2 and verse 1. And Joshua the son of Nun sent out of Shittim two men to spy secretly, saying, "Go view the land, even Jericho." And they went and came into a harlot's house. They went and they made a beeline to the harlot's house, I guess, named Rahab, and lodged there. I'm sure that's where they're looking for, a resting place. But that's another story. And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, "Behold, there came men in hither tonight of the children of Israel to search out the country." News was out that there was somebody or someone or a group of individuals that are spying and some. Where in Jericho they were hiding out. And the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, "Bring forth the men that are come to thee." Of course, the king being a smart king, if you really think about it, at least in this aspect, we're all desert wanderers would go once they have a little freedom. At least in this king's mind. And he was right. "Bring forth the men that are come to thee, which are entered into thy house, for they be come to search out all the country." And the woman took the two men and hid them, and said, "Thus there came men unto me, but I wist not whence they were." They were here, but they're not here any longer. I guess they did their business and moved on. "And it came to pass about the time of shutting of the gate, when it was dark, that the men went out. Where the men went, I wot not. Pursue after them quickly, for ye shall overtake them." I don't know where they were. I don't know where they are. I don't know where they're going to go. But I'm sure if you hurry now, you probably can't catch up. "But she had brought them up to the roof of the house and hid them with the stalks of flax, which she had laid in order upon the roof." She covered them. She hid them from the enemy, God's enemies. "And the men pursued after them the way to Jordan unto the fords. And as soon as they were pursued after them were gone out, they shut the gate. And before they were laid down, she came up unto them upon the roof. And she said unto the men, I know that the Lord hath given you the land, and that your terror is fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you." She heard the stories, what the children of Israel were accomplishing as they were marching closer to her land. "For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you." That was 38 years, that was 40 years prior when you came out of Egypt. "And what ye did unto the two kings of the Amorites that were on the other side Jordan, Sihon and Og, who ye utterly destroyed," possibly one of them being giant-like beings. "And as soon as we had heard these things, our hearts did melt, neither there remained any more courage in any man because of you." You're making everyone scared spitless. "For the Lord your God, he is the God in heaven above and in earth beneath. Now therefore I pray you, swear unto me by the Lord, since I have shown you kindness," literally the word there, "I have shown you love and loyalty, that ye will also show kindness unto my father's house and give me a true token or a sign. And ye will save alive my father, my mother, my brethren, my sisters, and all they have, and delivered our lives from death." And the men answered her, "Our life for yours, if ye utter not this our business, and it shall be when the Lord hath given us the land, that we will deal kindly and truly with thee." Truly with thee. "And she said unto them, Get you to the mountain, lest the pursuers meet you, and hide yourselves there 3 days, until pursuers be returned, and afterward may ye go your way. And the men said unto her, We will be blameless of this thine oath, which thou hast made us to swear. Behold, when we come into the land, thou shalt bind this line of scarlet thread in the window which thou didst let us down by, and thou shalt bring thy father, thy mother, and thy brethren, and all the father's household unto thee. And it shall be that whosoever shall go out of the doors of thy house into the street, his blood shall be upon his head, and we will be guiltless. And whoever shall be with thee in the house, his blood shall be in our head, if any hand be upon him. Now, to continue the story, which I don't have time to do tonight, Israel finally gets to Jericho, and her family were spared. Why? Because she heard what God was doing with the children of Israel. She was persuaded that God was with them, and God no longer was with, or ever possibly was with, Jericho and its inhabitants. So she had to make a decision, not just for herself or her whole family. I'm not even too sure the whole family knew about it at this time. Probably didn't. And she even took a risk, because you know what family members are like, those of you listening to me. What if one family member would turn on her? Before children of Israel would ever get there, the people of Jericho could have stoned her or killed her or slayed her, whatever. She took a risk, not just for herself, but for her family members. But she took a risk based upon what God was doing with the children of Israel. She became a faith of what God can do with individuals, including nations, the children of Israel, as they were marching through the land of wilderness. She even heard the stories of the Red Sea crossing. And I'm sure that included how the Egyptians were wiped out. She definitely included in the story how the Amorites were dealt with and eliminated. She didn't just hunker down and start living in fear and say, we're next. She started believing what she heard to be true. And she took an act of faith, a step of faith, which was an act of faith. She started ploying what she heard to be true and applying it and put it into action. And she came up with this plan with the spies. And of course, they were sitting ducks. They would have been caught if it wasn't for Rahab. I'm convinced of it. I don't think they were that great of a spies. If all they had in their mind was, as soon as they left the camp of Israel, once they get to the nearest town or the town they were designated to go spy, is to land up in a whorehouse. Think about it, folks. Put flesh and blood in this story. You see in Hebrews 11, once again, Rahab listed in the Heroes of Faith chapter, the Hall of Faith chapter of individuals that stood out when they had to apply the Word of God in their lives. It didn't matter how much of the Word of God they even knew, but they had to apply it. And you see it in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 31. By faith the harlot Rahab perished not with them that believed not. Some translations that were disobedient. When she had received the spies with peace. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they were compassed about 7 days. That's verse 30. And by faith, the harlot Rahab perished not with them that believed not, which she had perceived, or which received the spies with peace. She could have joined one camp or stay in the camp that she was in. She could have stayed in the camp of the non-believers, the doubters, the fearmongers. Well, maybe the children of Israel just pass over us. Or say, this is too much of a coincidence. I mean, I'm listening to all these stories. I'm sure everyone else did too in Jericho. I have to make a choice. I'm changing who I'm putting my trust and confidence in. And it's the God of Israel. And by stepping out in faith, not only she spared herself, but she spared her whole family. And James acknowledges that. Likewise also was not Rahab the harlot justified by works or righteous in the eyes of God by the way she employed what she knew about the Word of God. And it wasn't much. It was so far less than what we know today. When she had received the messengers and had sent them another way. For as the body without the spirit is dead, or breath is dead, so faith, pistis, the hearing and the persuading of it, without the applying of the Word of God, without having trust and confidence in it, is dead also. Is dead also. The choice, whether Old or New Testament, is the same. Either you're going to trust in what you think you know, based upon the circumstances around you, or are you going to faith both the pistis level and moving into the so be it level? And that's usually how it happens, folks. You got to hear the Word of God to remind you what it said, so then you could take it and apply it and put into action and putting all your trust and confidence back in Him and offer yourself and your circumstances. That's what James is saying. Faith without the employment of the Word of God is dead. It's like a body without the Spirit. It cannot exist. And that's what's happening across this land today. A lot of professing faithers instead of, as James would put it in chapter 1, doers of the Word. Doers of the Word. We have a lot of listeners of the Word, but they don't want to do anything with it, whether it's for themselves or for anyone else. I know Christians, as I was growing up in the Lord, that had the belief that all they had to do is show up and at least pretend like they're listening to God's Word. For God to count that as righteousness, I guess, so the Spirit of God could dwell in them. They were filling a seat. They were checking off a checklist item. Things of works that you think you have to do to impress God. Let me tell you right now, nothing we could come up with is going to impress God. When impress God, what His Son, His only begotten Son, did for us. Now we can live through Him and being reconciled back to the Father. And if we trust and have confidence in His Son and what He's done for us, and what He has given us as a commandment for us to continue to do, then God's impressed. But take it outside that realm, there's nothing you're going to do physically that's going to impress God. He's impressed when you follow His Son's commandments. Paul says what His Son's commandments are. James, Peter, you name it. And it's even prophesied what His Son's commandments would be, even in the Old Testament, which I never covered yet. And that is to abide in Him, stay connected to the vine, so you can be nourished, so you can show your love for others by nourishing them. By nourishing them. How are we going to nourish them? God's Word. That's how we're going to feed them and nourish them. With God's Word. From one side of this planet to the other. By God's Word. Nothing else will substitute for it. Nothing you can do to satisfy your conscience will even come close. You're not even the same page. Only when we have faith and trust and confidence in Him, when He puts to test the challenge in front of us, including the challenge to get His Word out there to the world, by the way, not just what it applies to your own life, but usually it starts there with your own life and what you go through. Then God wants you also to be involved, like I said so many times over, what you can do to nourish the rest of the world. He's going to challenge you. The faith tests are going to be there. Don't be a professing Christian. All you're doing is hearing me, but not applying what I've been trying to communicate to you. Some of you keep saying to me tonight, and I hope the word of God pierces you like a sharp sword. Well, I don't have a job. I can't communicate to you anymore. Any monetary offering. I could email you. I can make phone calls. But I can't give. Because I don't have a job. I have no money. I don't care if it's 10 cents. See, I'm not impressed with numbers. I'm impressed with your all. Now, you don't have to impress me. But you definitely have to impress him. And what presses him is faith. Not just talking faith, but living faith. Faith that has application. Not just professing it, but doing it. Kind of jealous with the Nike slogan. The Just Do It slogan they have. I wish I could adopt that and apply it to the Christian realm. Just do it. Just stop talking about it and just do it. Too much talking and not enough doers of the word. Just do it. Like I said, if all you have is a dollar in your pocket, I would at least send 10 cents. Well, I didn't want to insult you. Then send a note along with it and say, I only have a dollar. But I didn't want to be left out in participating in this great commission. So I'm going to send 10 cents of it. You think I'm going to be insulted by that if it's the truth? I'll be ecstatic over it because I know that's a sweet smell offering that pleases him when it's done with the right heart, with the right concepts of giving. And that's in the material sense. What you can do to help this ministry, as I said also, for reasons I cannot even explain, is to communicate by phone calls and emails. If anything, to encourage everyone here that not only just works a normal day, which most of you operate in, but then they have to put 4, 5, 6 hours after that. Every day, with very few days off. And they do it with a glad heart. Because they're part of what we're doing here. And part of the great commission that they've been assigned to go make disciples. And I can't even get you to email me? Email this ministry? It's not about works. It's about how it's going to help us employ the word of God. I'm sorry, I have to get this message out there. I'm dealing with a secular world. You would even think the Christian world would operate with a different perspective. No, they operate in a secular mindset, business mindset, operations that I have to follow. And guess what? They're impressed with numbers. You don't think when I go somewhere and I say, well, we have 3,000 people that communicate to this ministry a week, or 3,000 emails or phone calls, not people, but 3,000 emails or phone calls. They said, really? Yeah. You want to stop and take a listen to what we're proposing to help us get this word out? Like I said, too many of you are stuck in what you think employing the word of God is when it's concerned with the Great Commission. You need to unstuck yourself or unstick yourself and start being used as a vessel of God to carry out this commission if you are a participant of this ministry. I don't know what I have to say. Paul, James, all these giants in the Bible kept saying the same thing. So I'll just keep preaching what they preached. Keep faithing that the commission that God's given us, He'll give us enough people, enough manpower, enough finances to go where He wants us to go. I'm doing everything I can. I'm asking you to do everything that you can. We're going through the holiday season. You don't think I've seen a drop in emails? We're at halfway point. We're actually pretty good. We're halfway point already for the week. But our finances have suffered dearly. Why? Because people are putting their festivities in these holidays first and not God. It's the same problem every ministry has. You need to refocus on why you even exist. You exist to please Him and to serve Him, not yourselves. Deny yourself, take up the cross, and follow Jesus. The message hasn't changed. And just because it's Christmas and everybody's celebrating, well, I'm not sure if everybody's celebrating or not, but everybody thinks that Christ was born on December 25th. He wasn't. And in fact, I'm so aggravated. I like some of the Christmas songs, some of the better Christmas songs that are sung concerning Jesus' birth. I'm going to start playing them at a different period of the year, a closer period where He was born, just because I like them, and not wait till Christmas. Well, I'm putting Jesus first because, look, I'm decorating my house, I'm getting a tree, which I don't care if you do or not. That's your business. God's not going to fall off His throne if you do, as long as you don't worship the tree and worship your house. Well, I'm buying all these presents for my family, just like the wise men did, getting gifts. That should get me some points with God. Who are you fooling? Who are you fooling tonight? God wants you to put Him first, not those other things. It doesn't say that He will not allow you to participate in things that bring joy into your life and into other people's lives. But the message hasn't changed. Put Him first. And it'll probably make those other things more joyous than they were if you didn't. More fulfilling. Christians and non-Christians, there's a word for it I can't use on the air, but they do everything backwards. And it's nothing new. I've been preaching through the book of Haggai, and they had the same problem. That's why God said, examine your hearts, consider your ways. Because you put yourself first, and everything that's related to God's work second. Many of you listening to me tonight have that same choice during these holiday seasons. I mean, the holiday festivities that go on, Christmas and New Year's. I challenge you to put God first. Put God first. Everything else will come and go. But God will always be there for you if you put Him first. That much I could promise you. That much I could promise you based upon what others have done when they put Him first. Time and time again, when you put God first, He goes out of His way to look after you. Because He always has your interests constantly on His mind. And He's looking after you. But he wants to find individuals that would just not be professing faithers, but Christians that will faith and employ the word of God in their lives just about everything they do, wherever they go, whoever they talk to. They'll be employing the word of God. A living testimony. If we are to be a servant, which offers our services to the Lord, willingly, by the way, then being a willing servant, aren't you just looking for the next time you have the opportunity to participate in employing that word of God to nourish others that haven't received it? I'm trying so many different ways to make you understand. God has chosen you to serve him to fulfill the Great Commission. Now, if I have gotten that point across, even through James, then I've been successful. If I haven't, I'll keep hammering at it. Believe me, I won't quit. Because I have hardly exhausted God's word on the subject matter of where to put him first and what he's assigned us to do right after that. The choice is yours. I can't make it for you. You have to come to that decision yourself. God first or yourselves first. For the body without the spirit is dead. So keep employing the word of God. So faith without the employment of the word is also dead. The kind of faith, and once again, the faith, that first level of faith, pistis, just hearing it, and even though you believe it to be true, is not enough. It gets you off the starting gate. It gets you in the door. But God now wants you to act upon it and start trusting and having confidence in him. In your own life, how you employ it to get closer to him, and also what you participate in, whatever ministry or church you belong to, in employing that word of God. Keep employing the word of God. Don't become stuck. Don't become spiritless. Don't become a dead body. Start being alive and recognize why you were called to the kingdom for this hour. It's time that you wake up. It's time that you take some action. There's no excuse on the giving part or the communicating part as far as emails or phone calls goes. I just gave everyone a perfect example that what even a dollar could represent. If you have the right heart. You've been making excuses. It's time to take that step of faith and start participating. And you're going to find yourself wanting to participate in the future and saying, God, whatever is available out there, let me be a part of, because I don't want to miss out in this wonderful calling that you have given me to be part of something that the apostles started after Christ left, which Christ asked them to do, to feed his lambs. The next step is yours. Play the song.